Hello, and thank you for watching my talk, WikiBreathing. I'm Christian Brickhouse, and I'm an administrator on the English Wikipedia. Today, we're going to first look at the history of wikis to 2005. Then I'm going to introduce the concept of reader incursion and the theory of WikiBreathing. We're then going to look at a case study of a series of unprotections on the English Wikipedia. And we're going to conclude with some discussion and takeaways. To get right into it, the first decade of wikis coincided with a rise in home internet usage. As these early online communities developed, the world at large was only just discovering the internet. Here we can see a graph of per capita internet usage for the US and Europe compared to the rest of the world. The first wiki was founded in March 1995, developed by Ward Cunningham. Ward's wiki was the first of its kind, and focused on the documentation of programming patterns. At the time, internet usage was growing, but still rather niche, even in the United States. The next wiki important in the history of Wikipedia is MeatBall Wiki. MeatBall was founded in 2000 as a fork of Ward's wiki. Sunir Shah founded it as a community to theorize about online community dynamics and what makes them thrive. Many of these ideas found their way into early Wikipedia policies, such as assume good faith and early versions of the privacy policy. The English Wikipedia was founded in 2001 by Jimmy Wales and Larry Sanger, eventually becoming the most successful wiki. The early Wikipedia was deeply intertwined with Ward's wiki and MeatBall, and as worldwide internet usage grew, so did Wikipedia. That brought with it a diverse group of new readers and editors unfamiliar with how to interact with wikis. How communities handle rapid growth is an interesting question. Keen Monroy Hernandez and Mako Hill present the growth of Reddit's r/nosleep community as a case study of how a community can successfully respond to a reader incursion. They identify three systems which contributed to this success. Strict and consistent enforcement of explicit community rules by moderators, participation of longtime members in moderating the community through Reddit's voting system, and technical infrastructure which eases the maintenance burden on moderators. Contrary to previous work, Keen et al. Suggests that social regulation is critical to a community surviving a reader incursion. By using technical infrastructure and effective community participation, r/nosleep was able to adequately socialize the newcomers without expending the bandwidth of its established members. This challenges previous findings with respect to Wikipedia. Previous work has identified excessive rulemaking and negative interactions with newcomers as reasons for reduced editor recruitment. The findings of r/nosleep suggest that it is not necessarily the rules or zealous enforcement which drives away newcomers. Rather, it is the design of the technical infrastructure and the cultural norms surrounding its use. Critically, this requires us understanding the failure modes of communities when they respond to a reader incursion, and understanding the alternate strategies communities have taken which did not succeed. As Wikipedia entered the mainstream, increased attention was drawn to the smaller wiki communities which existed alongside it. As new editors explored the internal policies, these pages would often contain links to their intellectual predecessors. Wikipedians would follow these links, finding a community substantially different from the Wikipedia culture they came from. This catalyzed reader incursions on Ward's Wiki and MeatBall, which strained the ability of these existing communities to socialize new members. In 2005, Ward Cunningham would introduce a new restriction mechanism to Wiki, an edit code word, in order to offset the effects of this reader incursion. During periods of high server load, editors submitting a change will be presented with a challenge similar to a CAPTCHA. The editor will be asked to enter a code, and sometimes the system will provide them with that code. In response to particularly bad disruption, the code may not be provided at all, preventing editing by certain people. Meanwhile, certain community members would be provided with codes that would allow them to edit the wiki even when the system would not present a code to others, functionally restricting contributions to only the most trusted contributors. This process of periodically restricting and opening the wiki in response to disruption was termed WikiBreathing by contributors to MeatBall Wiki. The goal was in fact to repel contributors, contrary to the idea that wikis would want infinite growth. For a community which has attracted more people than it can adequately socialize, breathing out is a way to save resources by attempting to counter the sudden growth rather than accommodate it. We're now going to move on to looking at case studies of unprotections on the English Wikipedia. An initial list of pages was created by Wikipedia editor Cryptic based on a database query that listed pages in the database which were indefinitely move protected since at least 2009. A random subset of this list was selected by me for move protection review, and as of this presentation, I've managed to review 55 of them. Of those, 19 were also edit protected, and of those protected pages, I have unprotected 7. These pages were actively monitored for 31 days, and I would revert, improve, warn, and welcome users as appropriate. Following the month of active monitoring, these interventions were reduced and maintenance of the page was largely left to the community. The data reported here are based on recent observations of the edit history of each page. The number of edits was counted by hand, and contributions of new accounts were checked to evaluate whether they were auto-confirmed. An account is considered new if they were not auto-confirmed at the time that they made the edit. The edits by new and unregistered editors were checked by hand, and importantly, the checks done for this analysis were separate from the checks that were done as part of article maintenance. Edits were primarily evaluated based upon whether they were good faith or bad faith. Good faith edits are those which were intended to be helpful. By contrast, bad faith edits are those which were actively trying to damage the encyclopedia, the most typical example being vandalism. It's important to note that good faith edits are not necessarily good edits. Often these edits are imperfect and require intervention from more experienced editors. A second dimension, then, attempts to capture the quality of edit by describing them as constructive or unconstructive. Constructive edits help build the article. They were either not reverted or they were a legitimate edit that prompted discussion or changes, even if they were ultimately rejected. By contrast, unconstructive edits are not useful. A good example is a self-reverted test. The editor didn't intend to harm the encyclopedia, but it didn't do anything particularly useful. And it should go without saying that bad faith edits are always unconstructive. With that out of the way, let's start by looking at an overview of the results before diving into specific cases. Here we can see summary data for each of the 7 articles we'll discuss. The status column indicates the article's current protection status. Daily views gives a rough estimate of the article's visibility. The number of edits gives the number of edits while the page was unprotected, and the number of non-auto-confirmed edits gives us the number of new and unregistered users who edited the page while it was unprotected. This sample is too small for reliable statistics, but visually there doesn't seem to be any obvious patterns. The visibility of a page doesn't seem to be a useful predictor. For example, the second least viewed page in our sample had the highest edit rate overall. Meanwhile, the most viewed article had a middling edit rate and the second lowest number of non-auto-confirmed edits. The visibility of a page also seems to have no relation to protection outcomes. The most viewed page in our sample was indefinitely protected, but the second most viewed page is still unprotected despite having a higher edit rate. Now that we've gotten a sense of what these pages are like as a whole, let's dive into them individually to examine what kinds of edits were being made. We're going to start with pages that are still protected. The article on cattle was protected in May 2008 and protected and unprotected in May 2021. In the first week, the page received 25 edits. 6 new and unregistered edits made constructive edits during that time, while 4 IPs vandalized the page. The page was temporarily semi-protected on May 11th following a number of disruptive edits that were not promptly reverted. That protection expired May 13th. In the following week, 22 editors made 29 edits, 15 of which were by non-auto-confirmed users, and only one was not reverted. On May 19th, I again protected the page, and that protection expired May 23rd. In the next 4 days, 9 edits were from unregistered or new users, and all were unconstructive. So on May 27th, I restored indefinite semi-protection. The article on David Beckham was protected January 7th, 2009, and unprotected May 2nd, 2021. The article is viewed roughly 10,000 times per day, though it receives occasional spikes, presumably due to media coverage. In the 9 days after unprotection, 13 editors made 17 edits. Of those, 9 were new or unregistered editors, all of which were reverted. On May 11th, the article was protected with pending changes protection. This allows new and unregistered editors to make changes, but they will not be shown to readers until approved by another editor. That protection expired on June 1st, and during the time, 11 edits were made by new or unregistered users. The month of June saw increased readership and continued disruption, and the article was indefinitely protected on June 30th. The article fraud was protected January 5th, 2009, and unprotected May 2nd, 2021. It spent roughly 40 hours unprotected before indefinite protection was reinstated. During that time, 11 edits occurred. 7 of them were spam, and the remaining 4 were reverts of that spam. Now let's look at pages that are still unprotected. The article Dance was protected due to vandalism on January 15th, 2009, and unprotected May 3rd, 2021. In the first week following unprotection, 6 edits were made, all of which were good faith. From May 13th to August 10th, editors made 63 edits. Of those, 24 were from new or unregistered editors, 4 of which were constructive. The outcomes for these edits are middling. In one instance, an IP received a warning, but when the IP responded, no one replied. Another editor made a benign change and was blocked for a username violation soon after. They tried to request a name change, but their unblocked request was denied due to template syntax problems. The article on dragons was protected in January of 2009 and unprotected May 4th, 2021. By June 1st, 33 editors had made 43 edits. Of those, 18 were by new or unregistered users. None were constructive, and following sustained vandalism, I protected the page on June 1st. That protection expired June 8th, and since then, 31 editors have made 36 edits. 17 were by new or unregistered users, and 4 of those edits were constructive. A 5th reverted vandalism, and a 6th was a non-destructive test edit, which just swapped list items. The outcomes of these edits were generally positive. Of note are 2 recent edits. An August 4th edit by an IP corrected a factual error in an image caption. The caption wrongly stated a town was in Russia, which the IP correctly changed to Sweden. And an August 6th edit by an IP improved the hat note to distinguish the article from the Komodo dragon. The article Flower was protected January 13th, 2009, and unprotected May 3rd, 2021. From May 3rd to the 27th, the page saw 35 edits from 22 editors. Of those, 17 edits were made by new or unregistered users, 2 of which were constructive. The remaining 15 edits were unconstructive and reverted, and following a series of spamming incidents, the page was protected on May 27th. That protection expired June 3rd, and since then, 22 editors have made 100 edits, and of those, 23 edits were by new or unregistered editors. 8 of those were good faith, and 1 was particularly constructive. An IP expanded a list of examples of how flowers are used so that it included witchcraft and esotericism. 2 weeks later, this edit is still live. The page remained unprotected and seems better for it. Since unprotection, the page has undergone a substantial rewrite, and established editors have been attracted to the page. There is a notable confound in that the existence of this study may have brought additional attention, but on the other hand, I am part of the community, and the network of relationships which produce particular edits never excluded me in the first place. Lastly, the article on Pablo Picasso was protected January 25th and unprotected May 22nd of 2021. It receives roughly 5,000 views per day, and since unprotection, has been edited 76 times by 43 editors. Of those, 32 were from new or unregistered editors, and 14 were good faith with 4 test edits and 10 constructive edits. The outcomes of these edits were generally positive. On 2 occasions, IP edits prompted experienced editors to improve the sourcing of the article, and 2 edits modified the section on his death, and those edits are still up over a month later. We're now going to discuss these results and discuss some conclusions as well. So let's revisit the suggestions of Keen et al., which we covered in the introduction. Those authors suggest that the success of r/nosleep in the face of rising popularity were due to 3 systems. The results of this study suggest that the last 2 were most useful in achieving successful unprotection. Participation of longtime members is important for maintaining quality and for demonstrating the expected norms of behavior. Similarly, the technical infrastructure allows editors to focus their attention where it is needed most, preventing them from sacrificing quality of interactions for quantity of vandalism reverts. The results do not support the idea that strict and consistent enforcement necessarily improves the ability of a community to respond to rapid growth. Rather, we see that in many cases, overzealous enforcement of rules resulted in the rejection of generally good edits. For example, an IP added content with a source to the Picasso article, but rather than convert the bare URL into our standard reference format, the edit was reverted entirely for being unconventional. The article on dance is a good example of this on a larger scale. Good faith editors would be reverted and notified of our policies, but in one case, an IP editor tried to communicate, but got no response. Another editor added information and was reverted without explanation, ultimately driving them away from the project. And yet another made a fine change, but was blocked for a username violation, and the unblock request was denied because of confusion about the template syntax. Strict and consistent enforcement is helpful, and in many cases, strict enforcement served to introduce newcomers to policies such as verifiability and no original research. However, the success of this strategy requires sufficient interaction between the newcomer and the enforcing member. This allows for the newcomer to be socialized into the norms, rather than driven away. The data show that the direct benefit of IP editing is real, but they suggest that the main benefit is indirect. IP edits which were retained without modification were rare, but good faith edits were not. Often these good faith but problematic edits would prompt further editing. Further, even the bad faith edits seem to have a substantial positive effect by bringing in experienced editors to new pages. On MeatBall, theorists refer to this as page churn, whereby edits to a page bring it to the top of recent changes, and therefore to the attention of a wider number of editors who otherwise wouldn't see it. The attention brought to the article Flower resulted in a substantial rewrite. When the pages are protected, editing decreases, and even those who watch the page may lose track of it. Editing, good faith or bad faith, prompts review, and in doing so, draws attention to mistakes, increasing the likelihood that they get fixed. The success of an unprotection depends on the tools available. What this study reveals, though, are the benefits of passive infrastructure. Many of the reverts were not performed by humans, but instead by ClueBot. These automated reverts are speedy and have a low rate of false positives. When ClueBot is effective, editors can spend more time checking the more nuanced details of edits rather than getting distracted by vandals. Similarly, the abuse filter and related infrastructure work in the background to prevent the most obvious forms of vandalism from appearing in the first place. The results suggest that further refinement of passive anti-vandalism infrastructure would pay dividends in allowing communities to grow. Before we conclude, let's return to the concept of WikiBreathing. As originally theorized on MeatBall, WikiBreathing denotes a community's response to increased popularity. Given the results here, I propose a model of WikiBreathing which does not rely on the number of newcomers. Instead, I propose that WikiBreathing describes the context of a cultural encounter. A wiki has a particular subculture, and this subculture has a prevailing view about its readership. Maybe they're all vandals, maybe they're trying to help, maybe they're just incompetent. Meanwhile, readers are also part of a culture, and they also have views on the wiki. Perhaps we're unreliable, or unwelcome, or hard to figure out. These cultures interact, and the outcome of those interactions is patterned. These patterns are what constitute WikiBreathing. A cultural encounter marked by suspicion and antipathy indicates a period of breathing out. The subculture, in this case, a wiki community, is suspicious of the good faith of those visiting, and so puts up barriers to protect itself. Similarly, visitors unfamiliar with a given subculture may view it with suspicion or even disdain. In the long term, this can lead to restrictions as the wiki closes itself off, and can lead to disruption such as vandalism and hoaxes. A culture encounter marked by mutual trust indicates a period of breathing in. The subculture does not perceive a substantial threat, and so opens itself to newcomers. In the case presented here, this is marked by the unprotection of pages. The visitors likewise have grown to trust Wikipedia. In the last decade, readers have become familiar with the concept of a wiki and generally understand that they can change the content. Rather than approaching us with suspicion, they generally leave us alone. For the most part, we're boring to most people. This mutual trust leads to the granting of permissions by the wiki, from editing to even more advanced permissions at various levels. As readers realize their contributions are welcome, they join in the co-construction of knowledge and consider joining us, even if casually. We've covered a lot in this talk, and I want to end by reflecting on some of the main takeaways we've gotten. Most importantly, I hope you realize that readers are not evil. Most never bother to edit the page, and those that do can be incredibly helpful, even if their edits are not perfect yet. Few of them want to harm the encyclopedia. I've shown that unprotecting articles has benefits beyond the immediate edits made by non-auto-confirmed editors. While some make helpful edits, a great deal of benefit comes from the increased page churn. How we respond to disruption is important, not just at a systemic level, but at an individual level. When reverting unconstructive edits, we can unintentionally bite newcomers, driving them away. Using edit summaries, welcoming and interacting with newcomers, and building upon imperfect contributions demonstrates the kind of behavior we expect and helps new editors learn our processes without reading pages of rules. Finally, consider unprotecting pages. The data presented were not unanimous, and in multiple cases, the pages needed to be protected again. However, we also saw multiple pages that can be opened up, and we would not have known unless we tried. Wikis work when everyone can help build them, and the encyclopedia would be worse off if not for the contributions of IPs that we kept out for over 11 years. These are the works I've cited in the presentation. And finally, I want to thank you all for watching. And if you have any questions, feel free to use the links here to either leave a comment on my Wikipedia talk page or send me an email. Thank you.